Good day and welcome to Big Bad Tech. I'm your instructor, Jim Pytel, and today's topic of discussion is capacity factor. Our objective is to introduce a common performance measurement known as capacity factor. We'll learn how to calculate capacity factor and discuss how capacity factor influences energy production. This lecture operates under the presumption that viewers watch both the energy and power and efficiency lectures, both available at the Big Bad Tech channel. If you haven't watched these lectures yet or only dimly recall their contents, please take the time to do so now. Let's start this lecture on capacity factor with a brief discussion about how awesome I am. When I say that I'm awesome, I mean I'm totally awesome. I do awesome things all the time, and I do them smoothly, confidently, with style, i.e. awesomely. My dirty little secret, though, is there have been periods in my past that have not gone so awesomely. Not only have I crashed and burned, I've crashed and burned upside down, backwards, and sideways, both personally and professionally, in manners unimaginably embarrassing. The point is, not everybody can be awesome all the time. Even me. If you were to measure performance as a single snapshot on one particular day, you might get an artificially inflated or deflated sense of how things are truly going. I'd like to think my history of awesomeness outweighs my brief but intense periods of non-awesomeness, though, and when taken together, places me squarely on the awesome half of the dividing line. This holistic measurement of performance taken over time is known as capacity factor. Capacity factor measurements aren't single instantaneous snapshots, but rather, they're indicative of performance over time. Capacity factor is a measure of how often power generation facilities like wind turbines, hydroelectric dams, and coal-fired power plants run at full capacity. To calculate capacity factor, one determines the time the facility actually does run at full capacity and divided by the time the facility could have been running at full capacity. Theoretically, all facilities could operate 60 seconds of every minute, 60 minutes of every hour, 24 hours of every day, and 365 days of every year, i.e., all the time. Obviously, this is way too much to ask of the real world where things can and do go wrong, and capacity factor is a measure of how close a generation facility reaches this ideal standard. Capacity factor is typically expressed using a percentage, although in practice I tend to ditch the percentage and think in terms of a ratio of did over could. If the answer needs to be expressed in percent format, you're smart enough to shift the decimal point as needed. 0.85 is 85%, 35% is 0.35, and so on. Expressed graphically, we can visualize this as a triangular relationship of capacity factor, did, and could, with did at the apex, and capacity factor and could side by side at the base. To solve for capacity factor, take the time the facility did run at full capacity and divide it by the time the facility could have been running at full capacity. To solve for the time the facility did run at full capacity, take capacity factor and multiply it by the time the facility could have been running at full capacity. If a facility really does run at full capacity for 24 hours a day, it runs at full capacity or 100%. If, however, the facility typically runs at full capacity for only 1 hour a day, the capacity factor is 1 over 24, expressed as a percentage, is roughly 4.2%. Capacity factor is a critical performance measurement for generation facilities because capacity factor affects the amount of time the facility is available to generate power. If energy is power times time, capacity factor affects the time variable in this equation. A generation facility operating more often will generate more energy than one that runs only occasionally. Let's try a couple illustrated examples of simple capacity factor calculations. Consider an industrial wind turbine. As you're no doubt aware, some days it's windy and some days it isn't. Let's say this is a 2-megawatt wind turbine that typically operates at full capacity for only 6 hours a day. The capacity factor for this turbine is did over could, or 6 over 24, or 25%. If energy is power times time, on a typical day, this turbine would be expected to produce 2 megawatts times 6 hours, or 12 megawatt hours, or 12,000 kilowatt hours of energy. Consider, however, if this same turbine was installed in a slightly windier area with an increased capacity factor of 35%. An algebraic rearrangement of the capacity factor formula suggests this turbine is typically at full production for 35% of 24 hours, or 8.4 hours. Again, if energy is power times time, this turbine with a higher capacity factor typically produces 2 megawatts times 8.4 hours, or 16.8 megawatt hours, or 16,800 kilowatt hours of energy. Compare and contrast the energy output of the two similarly related turbines operating in regions with different capacity factors. The higher capacity factor turbine can be expected to produce 4,800 more kilowatt hours every day than the one in the less windy area. If the owners were selling the output of this turbine at a wholesale price of, let's say, 4 cents per kilowatt hour, the turbine with the increased capacity factor would generate 4,800 times 4 cents, or $192 more each day than the one with a smaller capacity factor. If this pattern repeated itself for 365 days or a whole year, this turbine with a higher capacity factor would have generated 365 times 192, or $70,080 additional dollars. As this example is intended to illustrate, capacity factor has a profound impact in the economics of energy production. It is for this reason that the wind resources of a proposed wind farm must be thoroughly investigated before development. Windier regions result in wind farms with higher capacity factor and more profitable results. Let's try a slightly more sophisticated example of capacity factor calculation. As you are no doubt aware, wind speeds can vary from gentle breezes to full force gales. The nominal or nameplate power of a wind turbine is experienced only at a particular rated speed, typically around 12 meters per second. In the previous example, we assumed the 2 megawatt wind turbine and the higher capacity factor area experience exactly 12 meters per second for exactly 8.4 hours. The reality might be startlingly different. Wind turbines operate using something called a power curve, typically defined by 3 points: the cut-in speed, the rated speed, and the cut-out speed. The cut-in speed, typically around 4 meters per second, is when the turbine actually starts producing power. Between the cut-in speed and the rated speed, power output increases. At the rated speed, typically around 12 meters per second, the turbine generates its nominal or nameplate value, in this example, 2 megawatts. Between the rated speed and the cutout speed, power flatlines at the nominal value, and finally at the cutout speed, typically around 25 meters per second, the turbine shuts down to prevent damage. Let's say at 10 meters per second, this turbine's output is only 1.2 megawatts. Let's now take a look at wind speed as a function of time for a particular day. To keep this problem manageable, let's say this turbine typically experiences wind speeds of 10 meters per second for 2 hours, then 6 hours of 12 meters per second or greater wind, and then the wind throttles back to 10 meters per second for another 2 hours. If we were asked to calculate the capacity factor of this particular turbine, we quickly run into a complication, because although the turbine is operating for 10 hours of every day, it's only running at full capacity for 6 of these 10 hours. How can we calculate capacity factor for a resource with variable output? Simple. Think not in terms of time, but rather energy. How much energy could this turbine have produced versus how much it did actually produce? Theoretically, a 2 megawatt turbine running at full capacity for 24 hours a day would produce 2 megawatts times 24 hours, or 48 megawatt hours of energy. In actuality, this turbine produces less. For the first 2 hour period of 10 meters per second wind, the turbine produces 1.2 megawatts times 2 hours, or 2.4 megawatt hours of energy. For the middle 6 hour period of 12 meters per second or greater wind, the turbine produces 2 megawatts times 6 hours, or 12 megawatt hours of energy. Finally, for the last 2 hour period of 10 meters per second wind, the turbine produces 1.2 megawatts times 2 hours, or 2.4 megawatt hours of energy. In summation, the turbine produces 2.4 megawatt hours plus 12 megawatt hours plus 2.4 megawatt hours, or 16.8 megawatt hours of energy in total. What's the capacity factor of this turbine if it could produce 48 megawatt hours of energy a day, but in reality, it only produces 16.8 megawatt hours of energy? 16.8 megawatt hours over 48 megawatt hours yields a capacity factor of 35%, as previously. This is to imply that although the turbine experiences periods of variable output for a variable length of time, in this case 2 hours at 1.2 megawatts, 6 hours at 2 megawatts, followed by another 2 hours at 1.2 megawatts, ultimately appears as if it was operating at full capacity for 35% of 24 hours, or 8.4 hours at 2 megawatts. Either scenario, the real variable output or the simplified version, results in the production of 16.8 megawatt hours of energy, which is 35% of what the turbine could theoretically produce. What's nice about capacity factor is that it's a super convenient way of estimating energy output for a particular facility without getting bogged down in excessive details like the availability and variability of a generation resource, maintenance schedules, unplanned outages, or regulatory curtailment. Consider a massive hydroelectric dam consisting of 16 50 megawatt turbines operating at a 50% capacity factor. This most assuredly does not mean that for 12 hours of every day the river is quiet as a pond, and the next 12 hours turned into a raging maelstrom of whitewater as all 16 turbines open up to full capacity. It doesn't even mean that 8 of the 16 available turbines run at full capacity all day. It does, however, imply that the dam, over the course of its history, typically produces enough energy as if it was running at half capacity all the time. In reality, we might expect the dam's output to fluctuate daily and seasonally throughout the year. For example, water might be intentionally spilled to aid in fish passage, navigation, or flood control. Certain turbines might be periodically inoperable as they undergo maintenance, repair, or upgrade, and certain turbines may run at reduced capacity for longer periods. Ultimately, capacity factor takes into account all of these occasions in which the dam does not run at full capacity, such that it ultimately produces half the energy it theoretically could produce. Given this capacity factor and nameplate power rating, it's a very simple matter of determining the typical daily energy output of this dam. If all 16 50 megawatt turbines were operating at full capacity, this dam would produce 16 times 50, or 800 megawatts of power. If it did this for 24 hours a day, it would produce 800 megawatts times 24 hours, or 19,200 megawatt hours of energy, or more appropriately 19.2 gigawatt hours of energy each day. It doesn't. The capacity factor figure 50% tells us the dam typically only produces half of that per day. Half of 19.2 is 9.6 gigawatt hours of energy. All of this without having to worry about reservoir levels, seasonal fluctuations in flow rate, maintenance schedules, or barge traffic. Capacity factor is a quick means of estimating how much energy a facility can regularly produce. Again, energy is power times time. Massive power plants with large capacity factors produce massive amounts of energy. A nuclear power plant might fit this description. Smaller power plants with low capacity factors produce small amounts of energy. A small residential photovoltaic array might fit this description. Speaking of photovoltaic arrays, consider a small 3 kilowatt residential scale PV system installed on a house in a relatively sunny area of the country, known to produce 5,037 kilowatt hours of energy annually. What's the capacity factor of this PV array? Obviously, a solar resource will have a capacity factor of less than 50% because the sun only shines for roughly half the day. And during those times it is above the horizon, it will shine with varying intensity and experience varying cloud cover. Theoretically, this plant could operate 24 hours a day. 3 kilowatts times 24 hours yields 72 kilowatt hours of energy each day. If it did this for 365 days or a whole year, it could theoretically produce 26,280 kilowatt hours of energy each year. Capacity factors did over could. 5,037 kilowatt hours for 26,280 kilowatt hours, its capacity factor of roughly 19.2%. This implies that the solar array produces enough energy as if it did run at full capacity for 19.2% of a day, or roughly 4.6 hours. This most assuredly does not mean that the sun immediately rises and shines at full intensity for roughly 4.6 hours and then immediately sets, but rather the sun shines with varying intensity for varying periods with varying cloud cover, such that it ultimately produces an equivalent amount of energy as if it did shine at full intensity for only 4.6 hours a day. For solar resource measurement, this span of time is what is commonly referred to as peak sun hours, which if you think about it, is just another method of expressing capacity factor. 4.6 hours is 19.2% of 24 hours. Expressed using the time format, peak sun hours just makes it easy to quickly estimate the average output of the solar array of a given size. Those of you with a calculus background will realize the energy output of the array each day is the area under the power curve. 3 kilowatts times 4.6 hours yields a daily block of energy with an area of 13.8 kilowatt hours. If you squint your eyes just right, both scenarios, the real variant output in brown and the mathematical equivalent in light orange, yield the same energy output, i.e. area under the power curve, albeit the calculations employing the peak sun hour simplification is much, much easier. All things being equal, this 3 kilowatt array ultimately produces 13.8 kilowatt hours of energy each day, or 5,037 kilowatt hours per year, whether the sun shines with varying intensity for varying periods of time, or if it immediately pops over the horizon and shines at a full intensity for 4.6 hours, and pops below the hills, plunging the world into total darkness. We'll examine PV systems and peak sun hours in greater detail in later lectures. For now, you should simply appreciate that peak sun hours and capacity factor both influence the amount of time a facility is able to generate. There's simply different methods of expressing the same quantity. Before we bring this lecture to a close, let me remind you, as I hope these examples have illustrated, facilities with high capacity factors generate a lot of energy and as a result are more economically successful. If you're in the energy business, Even a small increase in capacity factor reaps tremendous financial rewards. It is for this reason that the intelligent scheduling of routine maintenance and the timely repair of critical systems during periods of high resource availability are so important. All right, that's about it for today. In conclusion, this lecture presented capacity factor calculations, where capacity factor is a performance measurement of how much energy was generated versus how much could have been generated. Remember to review these concepts as often as you need to really drive it home. Imagine how well lab will go if you know what you're doing. Thank you very much for your attention and interest. We'll see you again during the next lecture of our series. Remember to tell your lazy lab partner about this resource. Be sure to check out the Big Bad Tech channel for additional resources and updates.